So if I from Iran, or the Mizrahim from the Arab and Muslim countries, Middle Easterns, if the Middle East and the Arab environment is seen as a jungle that you need to protect yourself from in within those walls of your imaginary villa, then what does it say about us, the natives of the jungle, that now Israel has no choice but to allow in, by the way, very much unwillingly, and if you see the protocols of the government discussions before, prior to the arrival of the Mizrahi communities, you would be horrified the way they spoke about the Mizrahi, whom they had yet to meet, yeah? Before the Mizrahi is done here. You see, really like progressive people like Abba Evan saying things like, we should be very, very careful. A race, by the way, race was the word, the term that they used, referring to the Mizrahim, a new race unlike anything we've known so far. A barbarian race is doing its way over. That was the editorial article in Haaretz. And you all know Haaretz as the most liberal, progressive newspaper in Israel. That was an editorial article in Haaretz. Abba Evan said, we should be very, very careful not to allow the Mizrahim to deteriorate us to the cultural level of the countries from which they arrive. Now, I grew up in Iran. I look at it almost with pity, because I look at the cultural situation of Israel today, and I know I came from, you know, the cradle of Eastern civilization, Iran. And I say, you wish to be deteriorated to the cultural level of Iran that you despise so much. But that was the mindset that brought the Mizrahim to the state of Israel. And now how much time? 10 minutes. Sorry. 10 minutes is definitely not enough to go through all the discriminatory mechanism that. But I will refer to some and maybe say a few words about how it connects to the nation state law. A group of us, Mizrahi non-Zionist activists, initiated a petition to the High Court of Justice against the nation state bill from a Mizrahi perspective, saying that this. Of course, it's aimed against the Palestinian citizens. That's the purpose of that law. But it actually discriminates against us as well. Because whenever you downgrade the Arabic, the status of the Arabic language, or whenever you project symbolically something negative about the Arab identity, it projects on us as well. Now, it should be said that de facto there is very little in the nation state law that is new or that has not been implemented on the ground since ever. Yeah? If you take, for example, the article that that of course Israel is the nation state of only one national collective, which is the Jewish one. It's not new that the state sees one of its missions to encourage Jewish settlements. This is not new. Arabic has been downgraded from the status of an official language to an unofficial one. This is new only the jure, I mean, just by law, but de facto, Palestinian citizens had to go to court over and over again to force the Israeli different authorities to actually use Arabic as an official language. So de facto, it's not really new either. So why if you are implementing the Jewish supremacy so efficiently already for 70 years, why this law? Why did they need this law? It's a declarative one. It's once again to declare that Arabs are not, it's not really your country. You do not really belong. And that being an Arab is something to be looked down at. It's something negative. We want to push it in your face once more through a base law, which is like one of the articles of the coming, you know, the eventual constitution. So we went to court and we said, look, any of these articles, and we know that you're thinking about the Palestinians when you articulate these laws, but it actually affects us because for years we've been taught that our Arab identity, history, language, cultural heritage is not just not relative, it's negative, that we should get rid of it, that there is some sort of an unspoken deal that if we just, you know, strip ourselves from the Middle Eastern identity, from anything that can connect us to that, prove to the state constantly that we are the right kind of Arabs, that we are, although we look like them and we speak the same language and really love to listen to the same music and whatever, we hate them more than you and we are better patriots than you. And we will fight them and shoot at them and humiliate them in the checkpoints, because the Ashkenazis don't really, you know, it's a low-tech job in the army to actually stand in the checkpoints and humiliate Palestinians. You will find almost exclusively Mizrahim and Ethiopians doing that. So the daily confrontation, we will prove to you that we are good Zionists and please accept us in. But the fact is, we were never fully integrated into that project. We've had a woman prime minister, we never had a Mizrahi prime minister for 70 years and won't have for another 70 years. Because the best that we can do is upgrade our position in this imaginary villa a little bit. Never make it to the living room, never. The encouragement of Jewish settlements, how is this being done? Except for building for Jews and not building for Palestinians. One of the mechanisms is Vadot Kabbalah, selection committees, yeah? That the state allows communal towns to have selection committees, and without even having to explain why, they can reject anybody they want. Initially, those selection committees were put to keep the Palestinians out. But the Palestinians didn't want to come and live with snob Ashkenazis anyhow. So they ended up leaving out the Mizrahis who wanted to live in these communities and could never and still can't. And that includes, by the way, the so-called socialist left-wing progressive kibbutzim. You will find the racism against Mizrahim in these circles more than anywhere else in Israel. Because it's very nice to be in an all-white Ashkenazi kibbutz and go to a demonstration against the occupation once in a while, but come back to the kibbutz, to your kibbutz that was built on a destroyed Palestinian village in 1948 and never have to be accountable for that. Because we keep the discourse of about the occupation in 1967. We never want to talk about what happened here actually in 1948. Because then we will need to go to talk about Ashkenazi privileges. Yeah, we don't want to do that. The downgrading of the Arabic language. of the status of the Arabic language from an official one to a non-official one. Believe me, the Palestinians will speak Arabic even if it's not an official language. But you know how many Jewish Israelis can speak Arabic today? We are talking about a state that has 20% of its own citizens Palestinian Arabic speaking, and is surrounded entirely by Arabic speaking countries. How many percent of the Jews do you think in Israel can speak Arabic?
Less.
And when you go and you check in the Mizrahi, it's even less. So the language that their grandparents spoke until like two generations ago, gone, because you don't want to. Because when in high school, if you get a choice and you need to choose a third language, because English we have to, so they usually give you a choice between Arabic, French, maybe Spanish. I had the choice of Yiddish also. The Mizrahis would be the first to run away as far as they can from Arabic, because we look Arab enough. I mean, we don't want to be speaking Arabic also, and then, you know, they really won't tell us anymore. So there is an alternative to, I mean, I know that it sounds very gloomy, but really there are other options. There are other options, and we know how to imagine them. But my time is up, and maybe that will come up. Thank you.
I could listen to her for hours, but yes, we're limited with time. I was asked actually down below to ask you, what's the percentage of the Mizrahi Jews in Israel?
That's a little bit of a tricky question, because the Chief Bureau of Statistics doesn't like to, I mean, we are all Jews, we don't do this. Roughly after the big Russian-speaking communities immigration, I think it's about 50% of the Jewish population that has some Mizrahi origin. It's true that there are mixed marriages. I'm married to an Ashkenazi. It's no, by the way, with all my feminist beliefs and everything, the minute I got married, I adopted his last name because it doesn't sound Mizrahi, and I knew that it would be much easier to get along with a non Mizrahi sounding. So when we're talking about Mizrahi, we're talking about, you know, Mizrahi, when it's vivid, if it's a Mizrahi last name or origin, or something, and then it's about 50% of the Jewish population.
So we're going to do some questions, but before we do that, we've been doing quite a few talks, and just generally AJDS has done many talks. And what happens is we have a panel, or we have a speaker, and then we have question time. And it's commonly a similar group, a cohort of people are asking questions. And we really want to take the time to maybe, if you've spoken at many of our events and asked questions at many of our events, maybe kind of give other people a chance to have an opportunity to speak and to ask a question, and also think about the question that you want to ask, and whether it's something that you could possibly Google get an answer on. You know, Orly carries a really heavy weight with the knowledge and the role that she takes on, and it's not. I don't think it's the right way to kind of conduct ourselves as a community. I think it really is about whether, I guess it's honouring the work that you do, which is incredible, and paying respect to, I guess, the knowledge that she carries. And so We've got two Yaels on either side of the room, bigs and littles. They have mics, and so if you guys can, people, put your hands up and think about what you're going to ask. Please ask a question and make it short.
So much for talking. I thought this was really interesting. I'm from a Sephardic background from Singapore, and something that I know growing up is that Judaism is often erased from people's identity if they are not from a European background. And I was really interested in what you said about the idea of the occupation hurting Judaism. I was wondering, would you also say that it is also marginalizing this idea of what being Jewish or being from Jewish heritage means?
Idea of what it means to be Jewish separately from the Israeli or the Zionist identity. I think that one of the most problematic trends that we've been seeing in the past years is the attempt, tell me if I'm answering, I'm not sure this answers your question, but the attempt to identify Judaism with Zionism, and then if you're criticizing Zionism or the Israeli policies, then if you're not Jewish, then you're anti-Semite, and if you are Jewish, then you are, as I found out today in this article, a self-hating Jew, or an auto-anti-Semite, and we have plenty of vocabulary for that. Ironically, by the way, Iran is one of the only places on earth that still makes this distinction between Judaism and Zionism, and though very anti-Zionist, the Jewish community is not only protected but celebrated in Iran. I have still family, and you know, they have their synagogue, they go to the Jewish school, they have a representative in the parliament. So I definitely think that there is a very, very worrying attempt to do that, and this is exactly one of the reasons that we, as Jews, it's not just out of solidarity with Palestinians, we need to, I mean, it also should, you know, we should also restrict it, but Judaism existed pretty fair amount of time before Zionism, and I'm sure it will after also. But it's in our interest really to make the distinction. It's not that it hurts the core of Judaism itself. Jewish thinking is someplace else completely. But it narrows down our possibilities of Judaism, and I think that this is really boring. Did I answer?
Just a quick question. What gives you hope for the future?
Assuming I have hope for the future. And listen, if you ask me, I don't think I'll live to see a change, honestly speaking. Because the global setting is as bad as it can get. So first, I think, you know, more people, decent people should do what the decent thing. So it's not out of hope necessarily, it's about moral obligation. But then again, I recently got to visit twice South Africa, and things do change. Sometimes they change without being prepared, sometimes they change. I just think that this project is not sustainable. Its inherent paradoxes and contradictions will prevent it from lasting much longer. That's my belief. And it's not hope in the bright, optimistic way, but it's a prospect for the future. And that, therefore, I really think that our mission right now is to be prepared for the day after. When Zionism collapses, and I think it will, because, again, the contradictions, the inner contradictions, are too much for it to sustain. And I think that our mission right now is to be prepared for the day after. But it's not hope. I don't see it in the horizon.
Terms of, for instance, I think it's adopted Jabotinsky.